The Super Cub and I are old friends. We spent a lot of time together. It's not a fast airplane, but on wheels, floats, or skis, it'll get in and out of just about anywhere. I fly a Cub in the Rocky Mountains, a land Aboriginal people say is the backbone of the world. They call it the Shining Mountains. My great-grandfather walked in these mountains, and sometimes when I look down, I think I see his footprints. To him, this was the Wild West. There was so much wilderness and wildlife, he thought it would last forever. He was wrong. Over the years of flying and climbing in these mountains, I've seen how quickly we're changing them. Here we are, only three generations later, wondering if the backbone of the world can break. I don't see as many caribou, wolves, or grizzlies down there as I used to. These animals are what make the mountains wild. Without them, we don't have any wilderness. It makes me sad to think that our great-grandkids may never see them. I believe the future of these wild places will stand or fall based on what we do or don't do now. I'm going to fly the backbone of the world and explore the mountains between Yellowstone and the Yukon. There's a lot of talk these days about this region being the wild heart of North America. We'll see. We'll meet people who are devoting their lives to better understand this place. Together, we'll explore our history, look at where we stand today, and consider what the Rockies' future might look like. We'll begin in Yellowstone in northern Wyoming. Established in 1872, Yellowstone was the first national park in the world. Early last century, park managers deliberately exterminated every wolf in Yellowstone. Today, the ancient predators are back. Canis lupus. The Rocky Mountain gray wolf was recently restored to Yellowstone. Tourists love them. Ranchers fearing for their livestock hate them. It's complicated playing with nature. Bob Landis thinks and lives like a wolf. He has to. He's a wildlife filmmaker. Bob offers us a rare opportunity to see wolves close up in the wild. He started filming with his dad 40 years ago in northern Canada. He thought he'd never find a better place to film wildlife until he moved to Yellowstone.
We humans have impacted the animals just by our numbers more than by anything we intend to do. So even as a filmmaker, you have to be very careful about impact, and it shows. The best shots are where the animal's natural and is not showing harassment. I used to shoot a lot of rear ends because the animal was running away from me and afraid of me. So those are probably the biggest changes, is that there's just more of us, there's more filmmakers and more still photographers. But on the other hand, we look at the wolves here in Yellowstone, and there weren't wolves here 10 years ago, so that certainly is an opportunity that I've never would have had if they hadn't been reintroduced.
Bob's father was a filmmaker and a hunter.
So I was raised with a gun in one hand and a camera in the other, and told to go shoot. And sometimes it was with the camera, sometimes it was with the gun. We had some really great trips together, usually in northern BC. We put together some films about the Alaskan Highway when it was first being built, as well as our hunting trips. And it just kind of progressed from there. I just kind of fell in love with what I was doing. Well, the gun puts the trophy up on the wall, and whoever your friends are see that trophy. But when you film a good action sequence, it's just like trophy hunting. I mean, it's something you quest after. But you know, how many millions of people see that sequence and enjoy it? And then it has the added bonus that the animal walks away at the end. She does it when you shoot him.
So Yellowstone's the oldest national park in North America, and it's probably had the highest impact from human use, recreation, development. Species have been exterminated, they've been reintroduced back into the ecosystem. I mean, it's a work in progress. I wonder, we as a species seem to play with the eco-balance so much.
Well, you said it right there. The Yellowstone is a classic example of a work in progress. And it really reflects our own cultural look at wildlife. There were good animals and bad animals. The predators were bad, so they were eliminated. Bears and wolves, for example, mountain lions, coyotes, they were all trapped and shot and poisoned right here in the park. And then, of course, we brought back the wolf, which is an animal that nobody thought would come back. We hope that we have a little bit more enlightened look at wildlife now than we did in the 20s and 30s. It has had all these different things going on here. It has been a research station that the whole world has looked at for their own national parks. And we hope that the reintroduction of the wolf then will be copied by other parks which are missing their large predators. And can once again, the park can be a model for the world.
Is this good?
Yeah, I think right here. It's kind of howling off to the right. Let's try tweaking that just a little bit, maybe a little bit to the right. So it's more. Right? Wow. Okay, yeah, take a listen, guy.
Man, that's beautiful.
You know, 10 years ago, no wolves here, no howls.
Man, that's fantastic. It's a beautiful sound. The howling that goes back and forth between the packs, or when they howl, there must have been a lot of research done about what the howling means, or is it territorial?
I think in this case, we're hearing just the communication that this wolf is trying to locate where the home pack is. So it was maybe off 10 miles away and heard the home pack. So that's the homing device for it. But we have heard situations where you might have one pack howling, and across the valley another pack would be howling, and that would be a territorial situation where they more or less are challenging each other, and it's the first step in really aggressive all-out warfare.
And how old do wolves typically live to? Do anybody know?
Well, you know, the last Canadian wolf died here this year at 9, we know for sure. So that was the oldest wolf. All the other wolves have come from those Canadian animals. But we've had a lot of die at 1 or 2 years old that, you know, they disperse and they have no way of, they don't find another pack or territory and they're killed by other wolves or by elk or whatever. So, I mean, the average age would be 4 or 5. An old wolf would be 9. Yeah, it would be an old wolf.
And of the 31 wolves that came down from Canada that were reintroduced to the system, none of those are alive anymore, are they?
No. You know, it was just a month ago that the last two died.
How many wolves would be in the ecosystem here now?
Well, if you include the, you know, area down to Tetons, and if you took maybe a circle 100 miles outside of Yellowstone, maybe 230, 240.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very successful as far as the wolves. They did it all by themselves. Either you love them or hate them, and I think that's true throughout history. You look at all the fairy tales, and most of them are very anti-wolf, and yet we have people that literally spend their whole vacation just sitting on a hill like this and watching, and you know, it might be 3 weeks of a very intense watching a wolf that might be 2 or 3 miles away through a scope. Yep, you love them or hate them.
I'm heading north into Canada to meet a couple of scientists who aren't as optimistic as Bob. Glaciers from Alaska to Argentina are vanishing. Glaciers are alive. They move, they make noise. I'd swear I've even heard them talk. They're fed by moist Pacific weather systems. It snows all year round up here, and if it's cold enough, the snow doesn't melt. Compressed under its own weight, it becomes ice. There's been at least 4 big ice ages that have ripped these mountains apart. The Columbia ice fields lie along the Great Divide, about halfway between Banff and Jasper. They're what's left of the last ice age. From this ice cap, meltwaters flow east, west, and north into 3 oceans. This is the drinking water for millions of people. As the Earth grew warmer and summers grew longer, the ice retreated. Plant and animal communities began to grow again. Only the strong survive at these altitudes. Few people know this high country better than geographer Brian Luckman.
So now you're actually standing on the crest. This is where the ice came to. And over here, there's no evidence for the ice having extended up there. So we're just going along here to look at the evidence.
The difficult thing to grasp about geological time is nothing remains the same. So if you go back to 60 million years ago, the continents were in completely different positions. The Rockies were, in fact, possibly in the tropics at that time. So the rocks give you a completely different story to what's going on at the present climate. So when you look at, you know, you look around you here, you've got rocks a billion years right the way up to stuff which was laid down this week. And it's difficult to grasp that history. The history that I deal with is basically the last 20,000 years since the last ice age.
Doesn't matter how many times you do this, it's always hard work.
This has been Brian's scientific home for 30 years. This time he's here with a colleague from Argentina, working on a climate change study that stretches from Alaska to Patagonia.
These trees are the real ancient trees in the Rockies. These are the oldest trees which have ever been dated in the Canadian Rockies, this species at this site. So we have a couple of trees at this site which were called previously, which are over 1,000 years. The oldest is about 1,100, probably. It's about 1,050 at this height, so we'll see what we can get out of this.
Really tight rings.
Holy mackerel. Right. These trees were growing under very severe conditions. This is one of the trees that we cut from up there. It lived between 1300 and the late 1600s. As you can see, the rings on this are very tight. The whole thing is only about 5 inches across, and that's a 300-year-old tree. So this is the kind of material that we use to build the long tree ring chronology on which we can reconstruct the climate.
Yeah, that's tight. It's maybe 200, 250 rings.
The visible evidence of dramatic climate change is obvious in these alpine regions. Glaciers coming and going is nothing new. It's the rate of change that's alarming.
So when the first explorers came through here in the early 1900s, the glacier would have been somewhere about here. So you can see in here, you've got the present ice front, and you can see these boulders in here. And look at this, you look down there, you know, you can see these ones, they're on the 1917 photograph. So one of the things that people don't realize very much about glacier fluctuation, they see the front of the glacier going back, but they don't realize that the glacier is also dropping, right? In 1998, for example, when they had a lot of melt on the glacier, on the tour of the glacier, they lost 10 or 12 meters of ice in 2 months. Okay, you see, here, you got little pieces of wood which have come out of the ice. Now, you don't know how old these are, but if you find a bigger piece, there are clues that you can use to tell you that you got an old piece of wood.
What kind of information can you get from that small piece of wood?
You could do a radiocarbon date on this, which would tell you how old it was. And we have wood from this site, which is 8,000 years old, which has come out of the glacier.
8,000 years old?
8,000. So this is the stuff we just picked up. These are very small slivers of wood. And they could be very old or they could be recent, we don't know. But if you hold that, if you get bigger pieces, this is what the real stuff looks like. And we found this last year. And you can see that this has been shredded, right? I mean, how would you feel if you went underneath the glass and were dragged around underground, right? That means that somewhere up here, 8,000 years ago, there was forest where there is no glacier. And on a day like today, it's very windy, it's very cold down here, you look at the forefield out there, there are no trees. Because the climate here is far too severe for trees, even today, even with global warming. So for trees to be established back there, it had to be much warmer 8,000 years ago, or the glacier had to be much, much further back. And possibly, in fact, the Columbia ice field didn't exist. And the real context here is that we now have one organism on the surface of the Earth which is capable of controlling and modifying the Earth's climate in ways they don't understand. Many people have described this as an uncontrolled experiment, but we're experimenting with the medium that we live in, that our children and grandchildren and all the generations after that will have to live in. And they will point the fingers at us if we don't try and modify what we're doing. If you come back to the Rockies here in
20,000 years, 30,000 years, there may be another glaciation. Global warming is going to be a relatively short blip in terms of Earth's history, maybe a couple of hundred years. But in terms of human history, it's going to be a very difficult time to get through.
The mountains are big water towers. They supply the critical water that we need for drinking, hydroelectricity, and irrigation. They nourish a complex web of life. But as glaciers melt, downstream flow volumes get smaller. Rivers get slower and warmer. The whole aquatic ecosystem is thrown off balance. Plants, fish, birds, wildlife, all of us are affected. And these natural water towers are drying up. Can we learn from an ancient culture that's adapted to climate change before? At the end of the last ice age, the first tribes of mountain people followed the retreating glaciers, making their home in new forests and grasslands. The Tanaka Indians have called the waterways and western slopes of the Rockies their home, well before the Egyptians built the Great Pyramids. I'm headed to coal mining country in southeast BC to meet Wayne Choquette. He's assessing the archaeological value of one of the Tanaka's ancient migration routes in advance of potential resource development. Flying over these open pit coal mines, I feel a mixture of guilt and apprehension. Guilt, because I burn fossil fuels in my plane, car, and home. Apprehension, because our demand for energy is predicted to double, and these mines will expand to supply the market. Everyone loves a profit. Wayne and a lot of other people are deeply concerned.
We love the Rockies and we can appreciate the Rockies, but we don't have the mature view to be able to see that we can love the Rockies to death, that we can impose our culture on them to the extent that while we're loving them, they're disappearing beneath us, and we run the very great risk of suddenly realizing that we've actually changed something to the point where it's not what it was that we loved before.
This relatively low grassy pass would have been an ideal route for early tribes crossing the mountains.
I've thought about going up here for 30 years, and from what I've seen on the satellite views and the air photos, it looked like it had a lot of promise, especially compared to a lot of the other passes. But being up here it's everything that it should have been. It has the good grassland, it's got the wide open terrain, the ascent and the descent are quite easy compared to the other passes. The ancestral Tanaka seem to have moved into this area from the south as a small group of people, and were very nomadic and following, we don't know what kind of big game animals they were going after. It may have even been extinct ones like mammoths. They don't leave a lot behind. They leave very small traces, and that's really what we're looking for, is basically the ancient litter of what has been left behind by people just moving all the time.
And what sort of artifacts have you found in a place like this before?
Oh, given the fact that this is a major travel route, we could expect to find almost anything that people would be carrying with them. Certainly regular type artifacts that would be used on the trip, hunting implements, things for repairing saddles, or in older times, packs and things like that. But mostly hunting related implements, I would imagine, knives, scrapers, points, those kinds of things. For an archaeologist in this area where we don't get the preservation of organic material very often, bone isn't going to survive, and certainly hide, basketry, those things, they disappear right away. All I'm really left with to work with is the stone, but that ends up being a very lucky circumstance, because the stone was the most important mineral in order to be able to make a living. You can't access the other resources, the animals, the plants, without having sharp edges. So the underpinning of the whole economy is this sharp stone that can be fashioned into cutting tools and chopping tools.
Even though I discover evidence of ancient sea life, I find it hard to fathom that this high mountain pass was once a seabed. I imagine traveling across this pass thousands of years ago with my family and the knowledge we would have needed to survive.
It's just a real shame that European culture, when it came in, didn't appreciate how much knowledge the people had, instead of considering them to be barbarians. And we need to learn, I think, the lesson of the cultures who, rather than imposing themselves on the ecology, learn the limits of that ecology and modify themselves to it. They've been successful at living here for 10,000 years, and all the evidence indicates that their population just kept on growing and their culture became richer and richer.
We talk about the balance of nature all the time, but we've got a long way to go in terms of truly grasping what it means. I head home to Banff when I learn that archaeologists are searching for the remains of ancient pit houses, shelters dug into the earth by nomadic hunters. It's ironic the site's on the Banff Springs Hotel's golf course, one of the world's most famous tourist destinations.
We're in the middle of the 17th fairway here on the Banff Springs Golf Course. And we've known this is an archaeological site for a long time, and it's significant for a few reasons for us. And one is that these house pit sites are unique in the Rocky Mountains, and Banff has got six or seven of them, and it's the only place we know of so far in the Rocky Mountains that has them. So that's cool. And the other thing is that this really was the first formally protected archaeological site in Canada. And it was set aside in 1912. They used to have little signs out here saying, "Easterly limit of house pit sites, fine for disturbing, $100. And, you know, that's a serious fine in 1912. They were serious about protecting these sites.
Today, 100 years later, scientists are back among the sand traps, equipped with computers instead of shovels. Gwen Langman and Bill Perry are hoping to see the pit house sites with the help of ground-penetrating radar.
What the software now does is that it takes all those lines, creates a checkerboard grid out of it, and at this point we can start mapping out the information by either depth or time as the signal travels into the ground.
Back in the early 1900s, when this pit house site was first described, they actually produced a map, and it shows the pit houses coming right to the base of the mountain.
This is it lined up against the base of the mountain here. So it's a total little village here of 14 of these houses that would have been built on this flats here. One of these house pit sites, one dwelling place, people have been coming back to year after year because we're getting a little series of radiocarbon dates out of one of them that was 3,000 years ago, 2,800 years ago, 2,600 years ago, 2,400. People are coming back and back to these exact little houses and using them on their way through the mountains. And that's pretty cool. We tend to think of the mountains in terms of our own explorers carving a way through great difficulties to be here. But everywhere they went, there were sites and people had been there before, and people knew this country so intimately, and they would have known what there was in all these valleys too. It's not a question of, a remote, difficult area for them. People were here and making a good living and using it as part of a larger territory that they knew really well. And that's what's so fun. If we can uncover a piece of that and try and figure out just what they were doing here, that's what's so exciting.
When you deal with the past, what you're dealing with are bits and pieces. So you're kind of like an ancient puzzle maker. As an archaeologist, that's the fun part, is this prehistoric detective business. And trying to tell these ancient stories is a real challenge, and it's a one which I enjoy very much.
Where did these ancient people come from? I'm going to find one piece of the puzzle.
The edge of the obsidian blade is down to a molecule in thickness. So sharp they used to use it for eye surgery before lasers. By 11,500 years ago, there's people everywhere, there isn't ice. No doubt about that. They're in the mountains 10,800 years ago, definitely 11,000 years ago, I would say, there's people in the mountains.
4,000 years ago, paleo hunters camped here. Archaeologist Marty Magny has spent a lifetime trying to solve prehistoric mysteries.
This is an outside surface test, so you can tell this is rough. This would be the cortex, so that was, if it was a cobble and they busted it, that's the water-worn outside.
Boy, that's sharp. So they can, use this for skinning?
Sure, larger chunk, yeah. An obsidian blade is the sharpest natural thing you can get. Obsidian blade is sharper than surgical steel. You take surgical steel under 40 power microscope, an obsidian blade, and the surgical steel is jagged and the obsidian blade is perfectly sharp. The edge of the obsidian blade is down to a molecule in thickness. They clean it. It's so sharp they used to use it for eye surgery before lasers.
Holding a clue to the past in my hand, I realize it wasn't very long ago, 50-odd lifetimes maybe, when we relied on stone tools to survive.
You carry something that's chipped so you get rid of a lot of the loose stuff you don't want anyway, and then have something ready that you can then chip off a large flake from, or already a large knife that's useful for a lot of things, kind of like a Swiss Army knife of the past, right? It's a knife, but yeah, you take a chip off of here, all of a sudden it's a chisel.
We've got what we call an ethnographic picture of when First Nations people were using the environment, how they were doing it when Europeans first arrived. But that only tells a very short time frame slice of the picture. And that's the exciting thing, is figuring out what the heck was going on and how these people were interacting in the past, where they were going to, where they were coming from, where they were moving to.
Northern tribes found their way south to become the people we know today as Navajo and Apache. But why they moved remains a great anthropological mystery.
There appears to have been significant climatic events that coincided with the Athapascan migration. There's lots of evidence for people moving great distances. There's a great piece of rock art in Grotto Canyon, Exshaw, just outside of Banff there, that's a Hopi mythological figure, the flute player. The next one you'd find going south would be in northern Utah. They weren't great conditions to live in because there was cold, there was horrible winds, it was ice and rock and that sort of thing. But if you look at the conditions under which people live in the Arctic today, it probably wasn't impossible for people to live here. But if people blasted through quickly to the warmer climes of the American South, then they came back up once things started to improve and those glaciers melted and the current forest conditions and everything you see here today started to come into being, people were moving back up north. And you think about the last 200 years of European occupation here, and then all of a sudden, whang, highways, towns, massive development in a very short period of time. It's a real contrast in how, contrast in two very different ways of life, from a hunting-gathering way of life to an industrial way of life, just like that.
We think of climate change taking place over long periods of time, yet within my lifetime, glaciers are vanishing. And Marty's got evidence of radical change occurring overnight.
This is actually pretty neat. This is Mazama ash. This whitish-pinkish layer in here that you see is a result of Mount Mazama blowing up 7,000 years ago, actually 6,800 years ago in southwestern Oregon. And can you imagine the force of that volcano blowing up so much that it sent a cloud of ash that must have been a much thicker back then all the way up here and past it. There's even traces out as far north as Red Deer. And it's a marker everywhere in the southern U.S. Anytime you find Mount Mazama ash, you know anything below that is 7,000 years old.
I'm just wondering how you tell the what's ash and what's dirt.
It's gritty. You put it between your teeth and it'll tell it's gritty. If you were to put it under a microscope, you'd see shards of glass. I'm gonna find this under here. You'll see how fine it is. Particular grit to it that soil doesn't have.
Oh, yeah. Aren't there Dene stories of ash falling like snow?
Yeah, there
covering
are.
Covering the ground?
Right, there are Dene stories and hare stories and stories of them moving when the ash and the mountains blew and that sort of thing. Yeah, they have stories, old stories. Some of them have to be about 1,200 years old.
From that explosion in the Yukon?
Yeah, the White River. Ashfall, yeah. That may have been, many of us think, the ultimate cause of the Dene Athapascan migration. There's often portrayed this conflict between scientists and First Nations peoples as to scientists wanting to say, well, you know, you guys came from Asia, you know, we're not immigrants, some people will say, you know, we've always been here. And scientists will say, no, you've only been here for 12,000 years. Well, First Nations friend of mine on the West Coast has said, you know, this conflict doesn't have to be like that. And he's a man who likes to balance his life. He says, you scientists can say we've been here 12,000 years ago, and we can say we've been here forever. Well, what if we just said that 12,000 years is forever? Can we live with that? And I thought that was a really good way to look at it.
Few descendants of the first mountain people still know the land the way their ancestors did. We'll meet two of them. With European contact came smallpox and the extermination of the buffalo. As a result, Aboriginal societies would be decimated. Today, tribes like the Blackfoot Piikani are back to their former numbers, but their traditional way of life is not surviving modern times. Archaeologist Barney Reeves has been studying the native peoples of southern Alberta and Montana most of his life. He knows the Waterton area well. He was raised here.
One of the reasons this area is so interesting is because the rocks here are very rich in minerals. So they're the most ancient rocks that are exposed in the Rocky Mountains. And of course, as everything erodes and the glaciers did this and that, and you get soil forming, you get very rich nutrient grasses, and then the, you know, animals eat the plants, and we have the largest mountain sheep and the record mule deer and the largest grizzly bears, and as a result, you know, the people eat the animals as well as the plants, and the Piikani were the tallest statured and the longest lived of any of the buffalo hunting tribes traditionally. because of this really excellent diet they had of animal protein and plant protein. You had a very productive ecosystem, and that's what attracted the people. Elsie knows more about plants than any other living Pekani. That's it.
Could you dig this out?
Elsie Crowshoe and her sister Margaret are among the few Blackfoot elders who still retain and honor the knowledge of their nomadic ancestors.
Cut it off.
Cut it off. Mystic up. I don't know what to call it.
Yeah, it's a really good.
We open this up.
This is a good one. Look, you could just feel it inside. It's really sticky.
Right.
Just feel this.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and you use that on a cut.
Yeah, on a cut or any source on your hands. That's how it works, all this Indian medicine. It has to be a person that was given to them. He's going to give them to you in a ceremony.
When I hold Elsie's hand, I sense how fragile a language and culture are. In one generation, they can disappear.
The old people, they travel all over, even along the mountains. And sometimes when they want to have a dream, some of them, they go out by themselves to sleep for 4 nights and 4 days without eating or drinking. And as a spirit comes to you and he gives you some kind of a protection or healing power.
They call the mountains Nastakas, which translates as the backbone, because this is really the backbone. You know, this is where all the weather is made. This is where all the water is. This is where the source of their sacred paint is. Source of their sacred medicines, their sacred plants, animals. It's primarily in this ecosystem. That's why it's so important.
And in the olden days, they used to, when they camp around, if they see any caterpillars, they go there and they start singing to them, and all them caterpillars, they start dancing. Yeah, but there's a special song for them. Yeah.
You know, when you're out there with them, it's, to me, often sad. Because this is the end of it. Once these old people pass on, there'll be no more. Because the young people don't have the knowledge. And they'll they can never get it. It's gone. And it's just, I feel a sense of sadness.
In the olden days, a shaman prophesied that sky beings would arrive from the east, men, white like ghosts, and powerful as mighty Manitou. These European explorers, and the visitors who followed, would bring about more change to the backbone of the world in the next 200 years than the mountains had seen in the past 20,000. The ancient shaman's prophecy came true. Sky beings arrived from the east. Men, white like ghosts. Game trails became footpaths, became trade routes and highways. The white men would bring about more change to the backbone of the world in 200 years than the Shining Mountains had seen in 20,000. It's challenging to fly safely through the mountains, but when I look down below and imagine crossing the Rockies overland 200 years ago, the prospect is overwhelming. Reaching the mountains, the explorers entered an unknown three-dimensional maze of cold rushing water, fallen timber, rock and ice. What they discovered was that any profits from the Great Lone Land would be hard won. I continue my flight along the backbone of the world in a region of the Rocky Mountains known as Y to Y, Yellowstone to the Yukon. We'll meet people who are devoting their lives to better understand this place. Together, we'll explore how the world discovered the Rockies. In the Alberta foothills, on the eastern slopes of the Rocky Mountains, one of the great prairie rivers, the Saskatchewan, emerges from the mountains. During the fur trade, this ribbon of water was the gateway to a land of riches.
We're in actually one of the original corridors going back 200-300 years for the early European explorers coming up here with their native hunting parties to haul the mail, haul supplies up to Jasper House from Rocky Mountain House.
Richard Smith was one of the last RCMP officers to patrol the mountains by dog team. He's been retracing the fur trade routes in the old style.
Man has been using dog teams now for over 6,000 years, and it goes back to our northern native people over in Siberia, and then the migration routes over to North America, and then the Inuit people. The dog teams were quite small years ago because the more dogs you had, more care, handling, more feed. Everybody ran on snowshoes and broke trail in front of the dog teams. They ran beside the dog teams and they would haul all their supplies, 200, 300 pounds of gear, and so they couldn't afford to ride on the back. Nowadays, the dogs are a little better trained, especially in voice commands, so you can be on the back and pedal instead of being out front all the time.
That's it, boys. Come on.
The fur traders called the toboggan their winter canoe. I doubt if anyone in modern times has seen as much whitewater pass beneath his skids as Richard.
A lot of times you'd have one or two guides out front breaking trail for the dog teams, and then within an hour the dog teams would follow up. And they didn't really have a good breakfast until they were on the trail. And again, you're talking pemmican, you're talking dry meat, beef jerky, you're talking a lot of bannock, and then of course hunting en route. And if you didn't find game en route, then you'd end up getting into some slim pickings, and you could almost starve while out on the trail, because you have to feed the dogs first and then yourself. The women are really the backbone of helping you get across the country. Yeah, the men were the hunters and the guides, but really, if it wasn't for the women, they would have great difficulty having the tools and the clothing and the transportation to get from point A to point B. And the European who did not adapt to the native way of life was the one that perished. So it was very important that the family went with you, because you just couldn't leave people for 3 months, 9 months while you went off and did your thing. So the family came with you. It actually made for a more efficient and effective trip. And everybody took turns breaking trail. Everybody would take turns hauling supplies and equipment, gathering firewood, setting up camp, getting food ready, repairing equipment and clothing so they could start out early the next day. And it became a very close-knit way of exploring our great West Country. You know, I wish we could go back in time to see the uncut land and look at the landscape and then look to the west and see those great mountains, the snow-capped peaks, the rock, you know, the backbone of North America. That Rocky Mountain Cordillera must have been some exhilarating moment for them, somebody to see that for the very first time.
Two 200 years ago, the fur trading companies were competing for a commercial route to the Pacific. The challenge, of course, was to find a path through the mountains. In 1807, a mapmaker named David Thompson, working for the Northwest Company, would finally chart a viable way across the Great Divide. Historian Brian Patton and I follow Thompson's historic map to the confluence of the North Saskatchewan and Howes Rivers.
This was the easiest pass. They used other passes, but this was a popular route.
Canada was explored so much more quickly to the Rocky Mountains than the United States because of the rivers, which were the superhighways of the day. And this is just about the furthest point up here on the house, just over this bluff, that any canoes ever made it into the Rocky Mountains, any fur trade canoes. This was the first big logistical problem across Canada. The rivers and portages were relatively insignificant till you got to the Continental Divide.
The men, women, and children in Thompson's party faced an even greater problem once they reached the higher mountains. There was no reliable source of game. They ran the risk of running out of food.
Yeah, and it was hard to hunt here. I mean, they'd see sign of these animals, but they very seldom could find anything. And they virtually were starving in this particular area, aside from one skinny black bear that stuck its head into Thompson's tent up on the house and got shot for its efforts. Yeah, I mean, the first thing a fur trader had to do, whether it was Mackenzie or Thompson or whatever, when they moved into new territory, find the locals and beg, trade for food.
It seemed they did a lot of begging.
Well, and they often did some complaining, too, at what they would have to pay for a scrap of food. But when you're out there in the middle of nowhere and you're not even sure, quite sure where you are, then the price goes up. What's the big bird down there? Osprey?
Yeah.
I don't know if I ever saw osprey up here. Should have, I guess. Huh.
Brian reckons this is where David Thompson made camp for 2 weeks in June of 1807. That's Howes River down below, and Howes Pass in the distance, where they were headed as soon as the snows melted. The interlude gave Thompson time to work on his great map, which even by today's standards is considered remarkably accurate.
The scale of today.
Well, I brought my GPS from the plane. I think Thompson would have found a GPS fairly handy.
Oh, yeah. I was born 200 years too early, I guess.
Okay, so we're going to come up 51, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 57 across to here. And then you can come up 16. So we're saying here 116, 46, which would bring us right about into there. and down, so it's all coming in
right to near the confluence of those rivers, yeah. I don't know. I would find that pretty accurate, considering some of the things that he was dealing with. And there is the thunder of avalanches with...
Well, you can see the avalanche
right there, coming off the cliff on Sarbeck. And these were the things that he noted. They would have heard a lot of this in June, you know, and especially when you have maybe a little bit warmer day than today. He didn't do, you know, a lot of celestial readings on these trips. This was one of the few places where he was sitting in one place long enough. You had to, let's look at today, you know, and maybe tonight, if these clouds would hold in, why, how do you do any kind of readings? And you get day after day of this sort of cloudy weather, and particularly in June when he was here.
Thompson considered himself more a surveyor than an explorer. Clouds or no clouds, he succeeded in mapping over 1 million square miles of North America.
Well, it's remarkable to think that it was just a white sheet of paper.
Yeah.
Without anything on it, and that he... How long did it take him to make this map, the great map?
I think it was a couple of years after he retired he worked on it. Yeah, I can't remember the exact time, but it was a long, tedious job, and of course, it was part of his final, you know, it's like when you've finally terminated a job and you still got that one thing hanging out that you have to get done for your employers so that you can retire. And that was sort of what Thompson was up against.
By 1793, Mackenzie had already reached the Pacific by land, and Canadian fur traders had mapped much of the Northwest. Americans Lewis and Clark owed the Canadians a debt of gratitude as they gained information from their journals. They reached the Pacific even ahead of Thompson.
In 1800, the order had been given through the hierarchy of the Northwest Company to cross this mountain range and establish a post on the western slope. And two voyageurs were sent across to winter with the Kootenai Indians. They come back in the spring with a young Kootenai boy who is bringing them back and then going to take the first trading party over to the Columbia and his tribe. But he's jumped by a band of Stoney Indians, and the Kootenai boy is killed. And it's another, 6 years before they're able to cross the Rockies. But if you look at that moment in time, if that Kootenai boy hadn't been killed in a silly skirmish when he emerges on the east slope of the Rockies, if that party crosses the Rockies and establishes a post in 1801, it's pretty conceivable that Canadian fur traders would have welcomed Lewis and Clark at the mouth of the Columbia four years later. That's a kind of an interesting thing. I've often thought about that, you know. How did the world discover the Rockies? We discovered the Rockies, the world discovered the Rockies through maps. This would have been the first images. Through words. Then the painters. And then eventually in the 1870s and the 80s, the photographers. So this was the sort of slow revealing of this mountain range to the world.
Slow to start, perhaps. But once the Canadian dream of connecting east with west was realized, it was full steam ahead. Building a transcontinental railway was about getting through the mountains and uniting a country. It was about luring British Columbia into Confederation before the Americans did. The construction of the Canadian Pacific Railway through the mountains of Western Canada remains one of the greatest engineering feats in the world. It wasn't until the railway pierced the wilderness that the West opened to tourism and settlement. Europeans and Eastern Americans had little wilderness left at home, and the possibility of visiting the western frontier was exciting. My son Jesse and I jump at the chance to take a ride on a restored CPR steam train.
Well, I'm glad you came today.
Yeah, I'm glad I did too. It's wonderful. Yeah.
We join author and historian Bob Sanford and his kids on a trip back in time.
That is Major Albert Bowman Rogers. And he was an early surveyor. He was considered to be the toughest surveyor and traveler in the entire mountains. And Rogers passed his name for him. He was also known as Old Blue Thunder. He'd take a chaw of tobacco, a can of beans, and disappear in the mountains for days.
Nice beard.
How do you think your dad would look with a beard like that?
Mutton chops.
Not that great.
No. Bob, when was it the first train came through here?
The first complete train came through this area in November of 1885, so about 119 years ago. And at that time, the railway had so little money that it had to take a very, very direct route down Kicking Horse Pass on what was called the Big Hill. And it was the most dangerous section of the railway line, the steepest and the most difficult. And here, engines had to be put on the head of the train and the tail of the train to push and pull the train up the steep hill through this particular region before the spiral tunnels were built. This was the most famous part of the Canadian Pacific Railway line. Well, it's fascinating when you look at how this was actually done. You would have an advanced army of not just surveyors, but people who worked to clear and lay the railway bed and lay the tracks. And the railway camps were quite substantial, cities in their own right. So you see this advancing army moving through the West, laying down a track that was effectively a highway. And the change in the perception of the West, which was virtually unknown, was dramatic and almost immediate. The Canadian Pacific Railway knew what was here. They knew it was a land of spectacular and diverse richness. And they were able to sell to the world the notion of taking the Northwest Passage across Canada by train and stopping in spectacular, virtually unexplored places en route. The railway advertised 1,100 unclimbed mountains in the Canadian West. So people came from Europe and from the eastern United States and eastern Canada to try their hand at mountaineering. And an accident at Lake Louise in 1896, where a lawyer from Boston fell off Mount Lefroy, stimulated the railway to bring the first of the professional Swiss mountain guides to the Rockies. And what they did is they took regular hotel guests who rode on the train west and turned them into mountain climbers. Brought a whole range of things. They first of all brought a whole new attitude toward mountains because they knew how to climb them safely. You didn't have to die in the mountains if you knew how to climb and how to watch for weather and how to use safe techniques. They also brought fascinating new clothing with them. Fashion. Check the high water pants, climbing and ties and jackets. With fedoras, these were gentlemen climbers. And the people who climbed with them were generally people who were just as sophisticated as they were.
The Great Divide is one of the most spectacular natural features in Canada. The continent's not flat. There's one broken high spine in the west. On one side, all the water flows into the Pacific, and on the other, all the water flows into the Atlantic at Hudson's Bay. And the train goes right across this spine.
When you see where they pick the railway route, it goes through landscapes that most Canadians and most North Americans didn't even imagine existed. They were landscapes of aesthetic power that were beyond timelessness. These were the very essence of what the world was made out of. And it was breathtaking. It was stunning to be able to sit in an armchair and actually move through a landscape this exotic, this dangerous, this amazing.
The CPR launched an ad campaign that couldn't fail. If you're tired of climbing the Alps, they said, come and climb a virgin peak. Or, if you prefer, paint one. The Canadian Pacific Railway recruited artists to come west and set up their easels along the rail line to create artwork for their advertising campaigns. In the art world, they became known as the Railway School. Art historian Lisa Christensen brings me to Lake O'Hara, one of the scenes immortalized by those early artists.
So the railway really opened up the West, and the railway artists brought it to the attention of the rest of Canada and the world. And William Cornelius Van Horne was a great patron of the arts in Canada by commissioning artists, sending them out to paint along the rail lines, having them come to places like Lake O'Hara to create scenery that sure was advertisement, but really they brought this wonderful part of the world to everyone's attention. Depending on how intrepid they were, they would go into the backcountry. Some worked right along the rail lines, like John Innes and Thomas More Martin. Others came here in the late 1880s, which was quite something to come this distance and paint. And to this day, actually, we still are discovering things from the railway school that we didn't know. It's a great area of Canadian history that we're still learning an awful lot about.
Lake O'Hara became a favorite haunt for the Group of Seven, the most famous artist Canada had produced.
We're just coming up on one of J.H. MacDonald's favorite painting spots. Nice little point sticking out in the lake where you get a grand view. This is where J.H. MacDonald would have been in 1924 when he did this little study. It's a great little study. It's full of energy, full of movement. You can see the glacier on Cathedral. Looks pretty much the same as it does today. Great reflection, great movement in the lake. Charged sky. And I love how MacDonald let his panel show through. In many instances in the Lake O'Hara sketches, the wood shows through and becomes part of the composition and reads as rock surface or as sky, as clouds, various different kinds of things. The people who lived here really knew the area better, and they knew when things would be happening in the mountains. They knew the height of the larches, when it would be. They knew when the breakup was, all those kinds of little subtle details. Whereas the painters, Group of Seven primarily, although A.Y. Jackson and J.H. MacDonald were exceptions to the rule, they wanted the great big soaring peaks. They wanted the grand shot that summed everything up. And they weren't as interested in the little details of nature. I think that beauty spots gain reputation very quickly, and Lake O'Hara has the best reputation, absolutely, without question. Even above Lake Louise, Lake O'Hara is the spot to come for artists.
I envy the painters. They seem able to capture a spiritual presence that many of us feel in these mountains, but find so hard to articulate. In the 1880s, the vacationing Vaux family from Philadelphia arrived on the CPR and were captivated by what they saw. Their photographic record of the Illicilewet Glacier in Rogers Pass amounts to the first scientific observations of the Rockies.
Between 1894 and 1939, there was a member of the Vaux family in the Selkirks or the Canadian Rockies every summer.
Henry Vaux, Jr. is renewing the family tradition of mountain photography. Walking among the old foundations of Glacier House, one of the first great CPR hotels, it's obvious that much has changed in the last 100 years.
My family first came to Glacier House in 1887. The people who came were my great-grandfather and his three children. They came here almost quite by accident on the CPR and stayed at Glacier House for several nights and wandered around and looked at the glaciers and took photographs. 6 years later, they came back, and when they walked out to the nose of the Illicilewet Glacier, they were struck by how far it had receded in just the 6 years since they had been there.
Joining Henry on a search for the site of his grandfather's observations is biologist Dan McCarthy. Carrying on the scientific work of the early Vauxes, Dan dates the retreat of glaciers by studying lichens. As ice vanishes, the lichens begin to grow.
The significance of the Vaux family, from my perspective at least, is that they were the first people in Canada to study an active glacier in a systematic way. They came back year after year, starting 1887, and photographed from the same rock, Rock W on their detailed map. What impressed me the most, I suppose, initially, was the beauty of the photographs. This particular site at the Illicilewet Glacier is the best documented, photographically, the best documented retreat of glacier ice in North America.
It occurred to me one night at the dinner table that it would be interesting to go back and reshoot some of those pictures 100 years later. Last year, Dan, we came up here without you in a group. You were supposed to be here following your instructions and tore all over the side of this mountain trying to find the rock. And I suppose when we got back, we had three or four candidates, and one of them is coming up ahead where we stood around and argued for a long time.
Well, this one here, you mean?
No, I mean the one up there, this one here.
Well, this was nice and flat. The position's just about right.
Let's just run up the trail and have a look at that one, just to satisfy ourselves that we've got the right one. Let's be scientific.
Henry Jr., like his grandfather before him, is a distinguished scientist.
Well, this one is certainly one of the candidates.
Oh, yeah. This is my bet.
Let's see what the picture looks like.
Here we go. Here's the test picture number two from Rock W. And okay, I'm going to get a shot, I think. Now, if I put on the 100mm lens, we'd see something a little bit different. There. The ice went up and was sort of a plateau just below where it is today. Notice up here there aren't any trees. And today you can see them right up on that
amazing
column.
That something like a tree has colonized that in what, 103 years. It's just, there's been so much change, it's amazing.
One thing hasn't changed in 103 years. The call of adventure still draws mountaineers from around the world to challenge the most dangerous peaks. By the 20th century, three railways had been hammered into the mountain interior, chateau-style hotels were erected, and the Rockies were open for business. Painters, scientists, hunters, and climbers competed to name, define, and conquer a mountain wilderness. It was a golden era of exploration and adventure. Photographers and filmmakers like Byron Harmon worked hardest of all to reveal to the world views from the highest summits. These landscapes had never been seen before. They invited the world to discover the Rockies. In the early 1900s, additional European mountain guides were imported to meet the booming demand for adventure. Cutting steps up peak after peak for their international clientele, hundreds of first ascents were claimed. This was the beginning of adventure tourism. But one mountain would not be easily conquered. The summit of Mount Assiniboine is over 3,600 meters above sea level and rests on a base some 80 square kilometers in size. It's one of the world's great mountains. At the turn of the 20th century, it was known as the Matterhorn of the Rockies. It shared a striking resemblance to the icon of the Swiss Alps, and it had gained a similar reputation of being unclimbable. Much has changed in 100 years, but Mount Assiniboine remains a serious challenge. I imagine the early mountaineers sharing the feelings of mountain guide Barry Blanchard and climber Bonnie Hamilton.
I was taught, like a lot of folks, that we fit at the very top drawer of the environment, that we're in control of pretty much everything. And I think one of the great values of this environment is you come in and you learn pretty quick that you're a lot of notches down from the power of what's going on around you. And I think it takes one real storm on a mountain for you to, as a human being, to realize how very, very small you are in this environment. And when it's storming, when the atmosphere is unleashing on these big mountains, how ineffectual anything that you do is. It's a drop in a tempest, you know. So I think those kind of experiences are valuable for human beings, period, to anything that makes you a bit more humble and lets you realize that you're part of something that's far bigger than you are. We're pretty arrogant as a species, and it's good to have our, you know, get us kicked around every once in a while.
I think about it every time I go out. Definitely, it's in the back of my mind. Being a mom is a big responsibility, and I take it very seriously. But I need to do my own thing and have some adventure and some excitement in my life, and this is what I love to do, and I think it makes me a better mom. It's what makes me happy, is being up here in the mountains. the thrill of it all and the adventure and going out and doing these things and not knowing what the outcome will be.
Continuing the long tradition of mountain filmmaking in the Rockies, we've waited patiently for clearing weather to climb Mount Assiniboine. We spend our first day checking out our gear and scrambling to warm up for the challenge ahead. Pat Morrow and his assistant Roger DeBeer are operating second camera on this shoot. Pat is truly a modern explorer. I've long admired his camera work on the world's highest peaks.
The Rockies, for me, were a perfect training ground to learn how to keep myself and my camera alive in a hostile mountain environment. And I've been able to apply the many lessons that the Rockies have taught me on expeditions to most of the other great ranges of the world. What I'm after is the personal experience of being there to witness that event or to witness that beautiful scene. And the photography and filmmaking really is a byproduct for me. You know, if the picture turns out and people are excited about it, you know, because it communicates to them, then I'm really pleased with that. But I keep telling people these photographs or this film footage can only represent a single dimension of the mountain experience. In order to get that total experience, you have to go there yourself to witness it. So I'm only the messenger.
Tomorrow we'll tackle Mount Assiniboine, where some of the best climbers have lost their lives in winter conditions like these. We'll start well before daybreak, but even then, we'll be hard-pressed to reach the summit and return before nightfall.
So everyone's got helmets, headlamps I can see, sunglasses, sunscreen, got extra gloves, harness, tools, ice axe,
yeah.
Got water, got a rope, got a rack. Everyone's packed their courage.
Yeah.
Good.
Inner pack.
We'll need the courage.
We're attempting an ascent of Assiniboine's North Ridge. Frigid air bites our nostrils. Darkness amplifies the sound of strong winds higher on the mountain. Everyone's quiet, anticipating the long climb ahead. The rising winter sun brings no warmth, and the multicolored dawn warns of unstable weather. I'm concerned for the safety of our team. Pacific storms have recently layered the mountain with fresh snow, and prevailing westerly winds have cross-loaded the North Ridge, creating dangerous wind slab avalanche conditions. Like plates sliding off a tilting table, wind slabs will be a danger on the upper ledges of the mountain.
Ask you what's it like to be up on these big mountains when a storm's breaking loose or to do some of the harder routes, and it really is like a small lifetime. It's just so rich and intense and alert and alive, and in the moment there is consequences to your actions. And I've always found that as you address a risk, there's often the voice of fear rises inside of you. A lot of what climbing has done for me is taught me how to control fear.
with this wind, it's going to be cold enough to get frostbitten here, so we'll have to keep an eye on each other, especially our faces.
Okay.
It'll be real easy to get a blanched nose or blanched cheeks, and that's the first sign of blood leaving the skin, and then the skin will start to freeze. So if you see that on me, let me know. I'll do the same for you.
Hypothermia is one of the greatest risks in winter mountaineering. Prolonged exposure to cold temperatures and high winds gradually lowers the body's temperature, numbing the mind and impairing a climber's judgment. In an environment like this, there's little room for error. Maintaining a slow, steady pace and staying fed and watered are crucial to conserve the energy needed to stay warm.
Hey, he holds me up on this one.
The earliest mountaineers would never have considered climbing Mount Assiniboine in conditions like these. They were more than tough enough, but they lacked the technical gear and winter climbing experience to survive up here.
Isn't life without risk. It's just part of life. We are pretty fragile entities, and it doesn't take much to injure or kill us. You know, you willfully go up into these situations where risk is amplified, and that to take life for granted is a huge assumption a lot of the times. And perhaps the purpose of risk is just to wake you up to the fact that what a gift of life is, and I guess to hang on to it as best you can.
We never actually conquer a mountain. We essentially survive, and by the grace of the gods, come back home again. The ancient ones traveled on foot. 200 years ago, a few fur traders arrived on horseback. In 1901, the first mountaineers stood on this summit. Then, with the railway and automobile, inroads to the wilderness began in earnest. Now, big industry competes with recreation to profit from these mountains. And the gods, in their infinite patience, continue to grace us. But for how long?